Andre and Alex and others have talked quite a lot over the last few days, as have many of you, about verifiable credentials. There's lots of important use cases and some really big market drivers, right? So there's work in Europe, there's the MDL work and other work that's going on that's really going to help to accelerate all of that. So digital wallets are going to be a really, really key part of this process, of this ecosystem. And we were very fortunate last year at Identiverse in Denver, some people got together starting some conversations that have resulted in the project that we're going to spend the next 25 minutes talking about. And so I'm delighted to welcome onto the stage now our wallets panel, moderated by Daniel Goldscheider, founder of the Open Wallet Foundation. Please welcome Daniel and his panel.
Good morning. Last night, I was trying to fall asleep, and I was picturing this large room. And I was worried that no one was going to show up for the last keynote. So let me start by saying thank you for being here. Now, I'm actually worried that so many of you showed up, so. Andy is right. It was a year ago at Identiverse in Denver that we got together and we started thinking about how we can help drive the wallet space forward. And I'd like to start by telling you a little bit about the Open Wallet Foundation before introducing you to my panelists and what we're trying to do. And I'd like to give you an analogy that many of you are probably familiar with. How are browsers, web browsers, that you all use every day, how are they being constructed? Well, obviously, everything is based on open standards. HTML, HTTP, JavaScript, all the standards we all use and we rely on every day. And then you have the browsers on top. Google Chrome, Microsoft Edge, the Opera browser, the Samsung Internet browser. All of these browsers rely on the open standards underneath. But there is actually something between the browsers on top and the standards underneath. And this is open source software. So why are they all relying on open source software? Why not simply doing, you know, your own thing? We think there are four key reasons. One is money. It's simply cheaper if you and I are building a browser to work together on the basic components for browsers and create open source software. Maybe you have all the money in the world and you don't care about saving money. Well, you're also going to save time. And if there is a security vulnerability and any one of you is a developer that fixes this vulnerability, everyone else gets to use that fix. And last but certainly not least, it will help with interoperability. Because even if all of us are using the same standards, if we interpret those standards differently, we may end up with a lot of friction in the system. So there are good reasons why the browser space is relying not just on open standards, but on open source software as well. So the super simple idea of the Open Wallet Foundation is to do the exact same thing for wallets. We have a lot of standards, as I'm sure most of you are painfully familiar with in the wallet space as well. Different credential formats, different protocols, different use cases from identity to cryptocurrencies, CBDCs, car keys, room keys, tokenized credit cards, tokenized debit cards. Lots of different standards. And of course, there are a lot of different wallets. And the idea of the Open Wallet Foundation is not to be an SDO. We're not going to compete with standard development organizations. And we're not going to launch our own wallet. We will simply focus on the building blocks on top of the open standards underneath the actual wallets. We launched just 4 months ago with 35 nonprofits and for-profit entities. You see them here. And I am proud to announce 7 more members who are highlighted. So at the moment, we have 42, and there are going to be some very exciting announcements about more members joining, both for-profit, very large, smaller members, non-profit members. And in addition to what you see here, we have something innovative for a chapter of the Linux Foundation. We have a governmental advisory committee. This is something we copied from ICANN with the explicit intent to bring the private sector and the public sector together, because we believe that they're all going to care about wallets. And I'm also really happy that Daniel Fett is in the room. Daniel, where are you? There you are. Daniel is one of the first two, representing one of the first two actual projects that were contributed to the Open Wallet Foundation. It's two SDJOT projects. SDJOT is likely going to play a big part in the EUDI wallet in Europe, and I'm really happy that we have those projects. With that, I'd like to introduce my fellow panelists. And Patrick, I start with you. Can you say something about who you are and who Ping is? I guess everyone knows probably that Ping also invented Identiverse, but what else are you doing?
Sure, so Patrick Harding, Ping Identity. I sort of lead product strategy, technology innovation there. I've been in the identity space for a long time. I've been to Identiverse since probably the very first one. We obviously are heavily invested and involved in sort of the world of decentralized identity with some of the products we've released recently, which I'm happy to talk about and why it relates to this. But yeah, so what's going on?
Excellent. Lofi, you actually are wearing no hat in real life, but two hats figuratively. Can you talk a little bit about both of these hats?
Certainly. I'm Lofi Jordan. I'm a business solutions architect with AMVA. AMVA is the American Association of Motor Vehicle Administrators. It's a member organization that represents all the DL ID issuers in North America, both in the US and Canada. And we advise our members on a number of things. Our vision is safe vehicles, safe drivers, secure identities, saving lives. And in the area of identification, in the past we've advised our members on physical driver licenses, on how to implement the Real ID Act, and that focus has now moved to digital identity. So in the digital identity area, even though we are not a technology company, we advise issuing authorities on which protocols, which solutions out there help them achieve solutions that are secure, that are interoperable, and that are privacy preserving. So those three things are very important for us to establish in the digital ecosystem as it is maturing or as it is developing. For us to do that, we are involved in a number of things, including standardization bodies. And as Daniel has alluded to, I'm the chairman of ISO WG10, which produced the 18013-5 standard and is working on the 18013-7 standard. We're also involved in other ISO groups. We're involved in Cantera, the Privacy Enhancing Mobile Credentials group. And we also do a lot of outreach across the ecosystem to relying party, to solution providers, to other issuing authorities, not only in North America, but also in other parts of the world. We'd like to synchronize our approach to issuance and issuance practices so that eventually it will be possible for us to accept digital credentials, digital driving licenses, and ID cards issued elsewhere in the world in North America and vice versa. And to that end, AMVA has, to start it off, created what we call a digital trust service, which in ISO language is a vehicle provider. It compiles a list of trusted issuing authorities, and not only does it mean ensuring the list that you're a trusted issuing authority, a true issuing authority, it also means that you comply with a certain minimum set of security and privacy and interoperability measures. So that in a fairly large nutshell, what AMVA is.
Thank you, Lofi. Ramesh, I am a huge fan of MOSIP. Probably not everyone here knows what MOSIP is. Why should everyone here be the same fan that I am?
Thank you, Daniel. Good morning, everyone. This is my first time at Identiverse, and I'm loving it. It's great to see all of you here. I am Ramesh Narayanan. I am the Chief Technology Officer at MOSIP. MOSIP is a modular open source identity platform. We have built it out of the IIIT University in Bangalore. And the objective of building this is that for governments to issue identities, they can build their own platform using the open source code base that we are building and releasing. And we have had fantastic traction in the market. We have the Philippines in Asia and the Morocco and Ethiopia in Africa already using this platform, and we have a dozen other countries whom we are actively engaging with. As we speak, we have 80 million plus identities, digital identities that have been issued using this platform. And the reason we went about building this platform is that when we set out, we saw that 1.1 billion people around the world did not have identity, and that was a barrier for them to get into the mainstream. So we wanted to make sure that we can break this barrier, and we imagined a digital native identity, and we are building solutions. It's still a journey, and we have been working at whittling this number down, and we have been successful to an extent. The latest figures, 4 years into our journey, are something like almost 900 million people. And I think, so it's not just us. A whole lot of you are also helping this cause. And we hope to make a big difference.
We heard in the first keynote that the answer to everything cannot be a $1,000 smartphone. And I love, Ramesh, how you keep us honest in many of the conversations when, you know, people from MOSIP say, what if the only thing you have is a piece of paper with a QR code? Or what if, you know, seven people in a family share a feature phone? And I think the work you're doing is so important, and I'm really glad that you're here. And I'm glad that actually every one of you is here, because you represent the pillars on which I believe this solution should work. Lofi, you were one of the very first people expressing an interest in the governmental advisory committee. You know, Patrick, you represent a for-profit company, and Ramesh, you're representing a nonprofit. The hope is that what you see here on stage is the nucleus of something that is going to work really well, that we're going to attract a lot of nonprofits, a lot of public sector representatives, and of course a lot of for-profit companies. So it's great you're here. Why are you interested in open source? Why are you interested in the Open Wallet Foundation?
Sure. So Ping is like a founding member of OWF. Basically, as soon as I started to hear about what you were thinking, it made sense for two main reasons for me that drove this. Obviously, Ping, you know, people here have probably heard about our Neo service, which is a decentralized identity service for issuing and verifying credentials. Very new, very exciting, a long way to go. But I think there's two fundamental reasons why OWF is important. One is that I think we need wallet sort of alternatives to the platform wallets that are going to be delivered by Google and Apple, and that we need, you know, other wallets available to people to use, maybe at the application level, maybe somewhere else, essentially. That's very, very important, really, to ensure that there's a sort of a breadth of usability there for people, and they don't sort of have to rely on a couple of singular things. That's one. The second, actually, is, I think, in the area of user experience. So new security technologies tend to fail and have historically failed because the user experience for consumers has been too difficult, too hard. Okay? I think there's a lot of innovation we can be doing in the industry around how wallets actually work. How they're going to be easy for consumers to use, essentially. I think, you know, I don't want people investing and spending time building these components at the sort of the standards level, essentially, and spending time there. That's easy. We know we can do that. It's actually how we assemble those into a wallet experience that actually is going to resonate with consumers and something they're going to get comfortable using and adopting over the next 20 years. I still feel that we are at even the pre-Netscape Navigator world level of like 1994 right now in terms of an analogy to browsers, basically. I mean, it's still that early. Honestly, if you recall Navigator, we haven't actually innovated much in the browser user experience in the last 30 years. It's really a lot of the same fundamental componentry in the browser now that it was 30 years ago. So now is the time for us to basically think about how we can make this work, how we can improve this, you know, what we can do to actually come up with an experience that's actually going to stick for the next 30 years in this situation as well. And I'd rather give people the components they can build these, you know, build wallets from, and let innovation happen, basically, in that regard.
Ramesh, you are already in the open source world. Why do Open Wallet on top?
Very good question. I think your opening slide talked about how browsers were done or are working today, and we believe that the wallet is going to be equally important in the future, just like the browser. And it's very important to get interoperability right. When we are issuing IDs through our program, our expectation is that these IDs be usable anywhere in the world. And it's important that these are consumed in a standard way and presented in a standard way, and that interoperability comes out of having a common set of standards and a common code base, a common interpretation of the standards. Right? It's very easy to focus on innovation and differentiation, but that actually is what breaks the interoperability. And we want to make sure that the ID that we are giving actually solves the problem that people are able to use the identity. And for that, this interoperability is very, very key. And that's why we are part of this initiative, to make sure that the wallets that all of you build will be able to use the IDs that we are issuing. And people benefit out of that. So that's one reason. The second reason is that we are not for profit. We run on grants. The money is difficult to come by. And we have to make sure that we are not reinventing the wheel all the time. And we personally, I'm also a fan of sustainable development. It allows us to develop responsibly and focus on the next set of problems rather than doing the same thing over and over again. Right? We have to make sure that our time here counts. So we want to make sure that we can contribute to the OWF as well as feed off the contributions that are coming into the OWF when we build the wallets.
Lofi, you are working, of course, on a daily basis with DMVs, the folks that issue driver's licenses. Why are you interested in open source on top of the open standards that you're so familiar with and that you help drive forward?
So we were very excited to see this initiative launch. Issuing authorities, as I mentioned earlier, have a need for solutions that are interoperable, that are secure, that are privacy-preserving. Open source in itself does not guarantee that. You need more than just open source. I think you need open governance to make sure that those goals are achieved. And that's why we think we want to contribute to help make that happen. We want to make sure that in this development space, everyone understands what the needs of issuing authorities are in terms of those three things. Security, privacy, and interoperability. I think it's very important also to understand that a DMV commissioner often is a political appointee. They're very risk averse. They don't want to have solutions that is the latest and greatest but may leak information of their customers to some third party unknowns to the customer. That's death for them. So they're risk averse, they would like to have solutions that are tried and tested. And I think a community such as this that has open source solutions, that has been vetted, that comply with those three requirements could be a real benefit to issuing authorities.
So, you know, if we look into the future, there's a lot of standards, there is a lot of momentum. You know, wallets are probably going to play a huge role in whatever Web3 is going to become. You're all experts in your own field. If you look into the future, What are your hopes, maybe some of the fears that you have? What can go right, what can go wrong in the wallet space? And any specific ways you're trying to contribute in ensuring that things will go the right way?
Sure, the future is what we create. And we go by an approach where we are trying to solve problems. And one of the problems we are trying to solve is inclusion. And so we imagine that the wallet is something, the digital wallet is something that's accessible to everyone, whether they have a phone or not. And so there will be multiple ways of interfacing with this wallet. It could be maybe somebody dials into an IVR system, and there's voice recognition, which identifies them, and then securely allows them to operate the wallet. Or maybe it's a kiosk, shared kiosk in a village, where somebody just goes in and either their face or the fingerprint is used to ensure it's the right person who's accessing it. And then this opens up access to services. So I believe the wallet is the gateway to access services. They prove the identity, they share information which is there in the wallet. And a lot of time I think there's a debate on whether we need to do information sharing or sharing of inferences. And I believe we are on a path to discovery of what's the right balance to make sure that the information is protected, but the right decision making can be made for all the relying parties who are going to use this. The key, however, is that we cannot create a digital divide in this process. So David earlier mentioned that $1,000 cell phones are not the answer, but that's an understatement. We have to understand that there are a whole lot of people who are not going to have phones at all, and for a long time. At least for the next couple of decades, we are still going to be making sure that people are getting mainstreamed. And the United Nations has a sustainable development goal, which is working towards this. The target is for 2030, but I believe the journey is going to be much beyond that. So in this process, the wallet is how people will be able to gain trust when they are accessing services, because it allows them to provide consent, have control on the information sharing that's happening, and it also gives them, it opens up the world to them.
So he talked about trust, and I want to piggyback on that, because I think that's, in my mind, looking at the future, a very important concept. I see a future where we have the tools, the protocols, the ecosystem in place where it's possible for a holder of a credential, say in a transaction where I buy age-restricted things, either in person or over the internet, to just share an assertion saying, I'm older than 21 and it's me. And the relying party will get just that assertion that says, the person who is sharing this information with you is older than 21. And the relying party has only one trust point needed to authenticate that information. That places a huge workload on the wallet, but not only on the wallet, the combination of the wallet, the operating system, and the hardware. In the solutions we have today, the relying party has to make the match between the person and the data. We have solutions that you can authenticate the data, but the relying party still has to make the match, typically using the facial image. In future, we see that match being made by the combination of the device, the operating system, and the wallet, so that the relying party just gets the assertion that the person sharing this is the person to whom the data belongs. That has tremendous challenges for issuing authorities, because as an issuing authority, I only want to provision into the stack that provides that safeguard, that confidence that at transaction time, this will do that authentication and work that I expect it to be doing properly. So I think there's quite a lot to be done to standardize this working together of these three layers. So that an issuing authority can get a certification at transaction at the provisioning time that this stack is going to do at transaction time what I expect it to be doing, and I can trust it, and the relying party can trust my assertion as an issuing authority or assertion as an issuing authority that this is doing what it's supposed to be doing at transaction time. So I think it's very challenging. I don't know how far we are, but we are often, as Bill Gates has said, we overestimate what's going to happen in the next 2 years and underestimate what's going to happen in the next 10 years. So I'm cautiously optimistic that we'll make good progress to get to this utopian vision.
So first, I'm sort of glad that we're not talking about sort of blockchain as sort of fundamental to solving these problems anymore, like we were a few years ago, or a lot of people were talking about a few years ago. So I don't think that's in our future, maybe on the peripheral, on the edges. I do think that given that everything we're talking about here really boils down to sort of managing private keys, essentially on behalf of users, I actually think we're going to start to see some of the use cases in other areas collapsing into the wallet as well. We're here thinking of this in the context of identity credentials in the world of sort of identification, verification, you know, maybe some entitlements and stuff like that. But we've also got a world in the authentication area around FIDO that basically involves the use of private keys to authenticate. We've also got a whole world in the area of payments. We might, you know, you consider it maybe cryptocurrency and stuff like that, which involves protection of a private key and a wallet to facilitate payments. I'm actually thinking that a lot of this stuff is all going to collapse together in the future into this notion of a wallet, so that you will be able to identify yourself, you will be able to authenticate yourself, you will be able to authorize yourself, you will be able to pay for things, essentially. Payments might not be crypto, it might be CBDCs, it might be Visa credit card networks, whatever it might be, essentially. But all of this will live possibly in a singular wallet where we can start to do all of this from one place. There's a lot of lessons that we can learn, especially from the crypto space, on what not to do, all right? Inventing terminology that is brand new to people, that is confusing people, that doesn't fit their mental models of how things work, I think is one thing we can learn not to do. All right, let's speak the language that people speak today, not invent the notion of cold wallets, hot wallets, stuff like that, that people don't understand. We've got to solve the backup and recovery problem. We can't expect users to basically have their whole world living in some device and not, you know, and leave it to themselves to deal with what happens when they lose it. We have to solve backup and recovery. And backup and recovery can't be solved with the notion of some sort of 25-word seed phrase that they have to write down or store somewhere that's the only way to recover their private keys. Okay, there has to be other ways to solve this. So, again, I think that one is a fundamental next step we have to get through, a door we have to get through to unlock the true value and power of this stuff going forward. But, you know, people are working on that, so it's good.
So we're actually not seeing a countdown here on stage. Andy mentioned 25 minutes. I'm cognizant of the fact that this is the last keynote. I'd like to close by thanking Mosip and Ping for your code contributions, the quality of, and really the success of the Open Wallet Foundation depends on the quality of the code and of developers and maintainers coming together to build open source software together. So thank you very much for that. Thank you, Lofi, for being here and for being one of the first people who volunteered as a representative of the more public side of the sector. And I hope that anyone here in the audience that is interested in a healthy wallet ecosystem, that you might consider you know, finding us after this keynote or emailing us or going to openwallet.foundation. It is free to contribute code, it is free to use code, and we really need everyone here who's interested in open source to come together and help build the wallet future we all want. With that, thank you very much.
Thank you.